Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Father, tonight we stand. It is to you we have come. And the Bible says, unto the Lord shall the gathering of his people be. Whatever you saw about us, whatever vision you have about us, that you have kept us alive, that you have not allowed us to be washed away among our generation, that vision must come to pass in the name of Jesus Christ. Those things that you saw, those things, oh God, that you have determined by your determinate counsel over every life that is standing here, nothing shall truncate it in the name of Jesus Christ. Nothing shall truncate it in the name of Jesus Christ. Esau was born to be something. But unfortunately, before he could realize his vision, something has tampered with his life. This night we stand to declare, every interruption, every distraction, every hijacking by the kingdom of darkness, we stand tonight to declare no way in the name of Jesus Christ. No way in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, there's a set time that Baba has set for us. That time, nothing will miss it in the name of Jesus Christ. So tonight, as we begin this meeting, I just want to ask that your divine word will come to us. That your divine counsel will begin to unfold before us in the name of Jesus Christ. I ask, Father, that every manipulation of Satan over any life here tonight, I stand as your servant, and by the reason of the anointing, we scatter such manipulations in the name of Jesus. Every confederacy that is not called by God, that have been sitting to see that these children does not walk into their inheritance, that confederacy tonight is declared illegal. So from this meeting, we scatter you in the name of Jesus Christ. Who says a thing and it comes to pass and it's not the Lord? Every counsel that you have taken contrary to the purpose of God over any of the children that is standing here, we command and declare it null and void in the name of Jesus. Thank you for hearing our prayer. And this night, Father, this word that you want to send to us, release it to us right now. Thank you for hearing. In Jesus Christ's name, we have prayed. Amen. I perceive that there's a reason why heaven is so mobilized about you. Because there's a critical matter that you are born to fulfill. And it is that that the Spirit of God is speaking about as regards the time, the set time for your exploits. I just want to read a very short passage tonight just to welcome you. Why is God investing on your life? Why is God investing so much on my life? Why is heaven so interested about you? And why is hell at a very critical rage because of you? Why is the devil annoyed? Why is the devil jittery about you? Why is the devil fighting tooth and nail? Why is he restless about you? And why is God focusing his attention upon you at a time like this? That's the short word I intend to bring tonight. And as we pray together to set this meeting on its course, I trust that the Spirit of God will bring a personal insight onto why is God focusing on your life. I'll read a very familiar passage to you, and I would like to speak for a little while. Please go with me to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Verse 23 and verse 24. We can read it up to verse 27, but what I look at tonight may not allow us to get as far as that verse 27, because I just intend to raise an issue of prayer, and then we shall pray concertedly together tonight before we retire and begin to get the meeting together. Hebrews 11, verse 23 and 24. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandments. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. I stop there for this night, but the message that I sense God wants me to bring to you is in that verse 23. And if possible, we get to verse 24, and then we shall stop for tonight. Why all the investment? The Bible verse we have read, like I said, is popular. You may have read it before, and you may have even talked about it, but there's something boiling in my spirit tonight about why God is focusing, investing, and fighting over your life. Do you know that every one of you that has been released onto the earth, there was a prophecy around your life that heaven is very jealous about. Do you know that actually you were born to fulfill a divine task? It's a pity that there were no record, physical record, that somebody may have kept about the discussions in heaven before they released you to pass through your mother's womb. And it's also a pity that some of our mothers and some of your fathers may not have taken a meticulous note of the musings, of the discussions that heaven had before you were released to come on the face of the earth. And sometime, because of that level of lack of understanding and revelation, you might live as if you were just existing. But there is a prophecy you were born to fulfill. And this is why the devil is enraged and has been struggling, fighting tooth and nail, whether he can confiscate that and make you a shadow of what you were meant to be. That's why I began this meeting tonight by praying with you that the things for which you were born, the purpose that was proposed for you to work into, the exploits you were born to carry out, none of it will be truncated in the name of Jesus Christ. It was very, very touching to me When I read in the book of Genesis, chapter 15, I want all of you to quickly check something in Genesis. We're not taking a long time about it. I just want you to check something before you return to where we are. In Genesis chapter 15, Genesis 15, this was many, many, many years before Moses' father and Moses' mother were born. This was many, many years even before the great, 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 great grandfather of Moses was to be born. There was a prophecy. Because when tomorrow I begin to talk about the set time for your exploit, then we will be understanding that there is a set time, because there is a set agenda that must be fulfilled at this particular space of time in God's divine arrangement, for which, and I want you to listen carefully to me tonight, for which you were born to walk and carry out. In Genesis chapter 15, I want you to read verse 13. The Lord was speaking to Abraham many years ago. And look at what God said to him. In verse 13, and he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that your seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them. How many years? God, who sees the end from the beginning, already spoke about what will happen to the children of Israel that were not yet born. He said, no, of a surety. What's the meaning of the word surety? Certainly. May I say to you, there are certainties and certain things that heaven is committed to carrying out in this generation, for which you have a part to play. As I'm seeing each one of you gather into this meeting, I do not take you for granted, because my eyes have been opened to see a little of what lies ahead of you. I do not think that you are just a bundle of students that I've gathered together. I've seen men and women of destiny sitting in this meeting tonight. I have seen men and women ordained for several years, even before they came to the limelight, on whose neck prophecies are hanging. And so as I welcome you into this meeting, I want you to know that there's something serious, something eternal something heavenly that is hanging around your neck, for which you are to be prepared to carry out for God. That's why bringing you to this meeting for me is not cosmetic. It's not a routine. It's not a mere activity. It's a very critical preparation, because in a short while, the reason why you were born, the reason why you were raised, the reason why you have been exposed shall be made manifest. And Satan is very jittery. He doesn't like this meeting. He does not want what he is smelling. Because if you break forth, are you hearing me? You will spell a doom for the kingdom of darkness. But whether Satan like it or not, the will of God concerning you must come to pass. We do not need the cooperation of Satan. Whether he likes it or not, the counsel of the Most High God concerning you shall stand in the name of Jesus Christ. So can you imagine? God was saying to Abraham, know of a surety that this thing is going to happen. And God was telling him, and said, look, your descendants, your seed, and he had not got one baby as at that time. God said, for you to know that what I'm saying will come to pass, your babies, your seed, they will go to another nation and they will serve that nation for 400 years. And after, I will bring them out. They will come out with great substance. And that nation that they will serve, I will judge that nation. God said this when Abraham, as of that moment, has not even got a hoof, talk less of a child. So may I inform you before I go ahead, what you were born to accomplish has been determined several hundreds of years before now. Why is God making investment? It's because the things that God has spoken concerning you has a time. Can you imagine that when it was about time for the purpose of God that was spoken many, many, many hundreds of years before to come to pass? Moses was born to a very, very insignificant family. But as soon as that child was born, I want you to note what was the matter. As soon as that child was born, the mother and the father, the Bible said, they saw that it was a proper child. You see, when they said they saw that it was a proper child, other versions that do understand it, they will say they saw it's a beautiful child, it was a handsome boy. No, 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 no. It's not the beauty that they saw. When they said they saw that it was a proper child, it was not because he had six fingers. It was not because the day he was born, 32 teeth out with him. It was not because as soon as he was born, he became extremely fair, fair complexioned. No. And I wanted to know that they even had other children before he was born. So what's the big deal? But there is a big deal. The big deal actually is the big deal. There was a deal way back, many, many hundreds of years ago. There was a deal that this young man is being released to the earth to carry out. So when the Bible said, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid by his parents for 3 months. They not feared the wrath of the king because they saw he was a proper child. And the Bible noted, and I was wondering why that decree. Some of you think it is coincidence. It was not. Satan knew that a child is about to be born who will bring the prophetic of the purpose of God concerning the children of Israel getting out of the house of bondage, will bring it to pass. Somehow Satan smelled a rat. And because he doesn't know, he cannot pinpoint. Are you hearing me? There's something about you that is cloudy to Satan. He does not know. He is afraid, is jittery, but he cannot locate your destiny yet. Everything, if he can get something, and he's only saying, just do everything in case you will catch her. He will not catch you in the name of Jesus. And the Bible said, at that time, there was a Pharaoh that was so wicked, who said, any male child that has been born in Israel, from day zero, what should they do? They should kill it. Once it's a child and it's a male. You can imagine that it is at that time. At that time of great difficulty, that it was also the time for Moses to be born. The reason is because there is already a set time for those things that must be done to be done. I perceive that when it remained a time for the word of God to come to pass concerning the children of Israel, God began to cause things to happen. I will have so much to talk to you about this thing as from tomorrow. God began to allow things to happen here and there, left and right, because God watches over his word to bring it to pass, and he never fails anything to happen outside his own time. So that night, that day, this boy was born when it was a crime to deliver a baby, particularly a baby boy. All the women in Israel, the Hebrew women, it was difficult because if they went to the hospital to deliver their child, all the midwives of Egypt, the Egyptians, have been told, any Hebrew woman that comes to deliver here, watch it. If it's a baby boy, straight ahead, just pack that baby. Don't mind their cries. Don't mind how beautiful they may look or how handsome. Tie them in a sack. Strangulate it. Go and throw it into River Nile. I don't know how many thousands died, But Moses was kept alive. I don't know how many thousands have perished, and God is keeping you alive. I don't know how many have come and passed, but heaven is saying, no, not this one. This is a proper child. Can you turn and tell somebody, has God not known that you're a proper child? That's why you are here. And if heaven has set his eyes on you as a proper child, how can you make yourself useless? How can you make your life a non-entity? How can you sell out? That's what is going to take me to that little verse 24, and I will be praying with you. The Bible said, because they saw he was a proper child, they saw the invisible about him, they saw that inside this tiny baby is the deliverance that God spoke about. Inside this baby is the prophetic that God declared unto Abraham. This is the young boy that will bring it to pass. Without cajoling you, and you know I have no reason to cajole you, there's no reason for it. If I were going to collect money from you, I say, for this prophecy to come to pass, sow a seed into the life of the man of God, maybe you could have suspected me. But you know that we're not going to do such a thing. You know that if it is not because of the passion of God and the love of God that has overwhelmed our hearts, there's no reason why we should be doing what we are doing. You know that if it is not because God has said something particularly about your life, why the investment? Why the investment? Why? This night, why is God focusing on you? It's because there's an exploit that you were born, and particularly born again, to carry out. And the time for that exploit is here. So when this choir began to say, the time for your exploit is here, is here, is here, I was just watching their mouth because I didn't know that they have composed such a song. While others were perishing, while River Nile was stinking for dead babies, and when Satan thought that any likely child that could do an exploit to break the yoke of Egypt over the children of Israel, when he thought that he must have possibly finished any of them, he did not know that there is a Moses. And I dare say that Satan has missed you. Satan, he said, I thought I have finished him. I thought I have finished that girl. I thought there's nothing about her again. But he will soon bite his fingers because of what you are going to be in the name of Jesus Christ. And the Bible said, when the parents of Moses could no longer hide him because it was becoming too difficult, They are saying, God, we believe that this child is a proper child. We believe this child has something to do in fulfilling your prophecy. We don't doubt that this child is a proper child. There's something about him. But now we don't know what to do again. And they didn't know what to do. And they just carried him out by faith and put him in a basket and went and put him on the river. And they were watching money day and night, not knowing what God will do. He said, Lord, we have finished all we can do. We are releasing this boy into your hand. Let your purpose for his life, let it come to pass, even if our hand can no longer handle it. Do you know that some of you sitting before me tonight, some of you, you don't even know why you came into this student congress. Some of you wondered how somebody invited you and insisted you must come. I know that in days to come, you will like to go and thank that person. Say, I did not know that it is God that is connecting me with my destiny. Can you imagine what happened? God decided. And sometimes I just like to thank God for God. How many of you have ever thanked God for God? Eh? You need to know how to thank God for God. You know why? God just does things that baffle me all the time. Can you imagine? God was raising this young man who will dismantle Egypt in a few years' time. And he decided and said, okay, let the Pharaoh's daughter come and adopt this boy and take him to the Pharaoh's palace and learn all the Egyptian language, so that there is nothing. The day when Moses is going to stand up to do his exploits, Egyptians will not be able to know what to do, because even if they decided to speak their local language, you know, sometimes when your enemy wants to plan your evil, what do? They start speaking in their dialect so that you will not know. But there is no dialect that Egyptian can speak that is not on the fingertips of Moses. God caused Egypt to invest the best of their education upon Moses. He went to the king's college. He was on permanent scholarship throughout. He had a retinue of officers who dropped him in school, and he had a personally assigned tutor to him. And they thought they were nursing him up to become the next Pharaoh. They thought they were building up this boy to perpetuate the bondage of his people, not knowing. Satan has made a mistake about some of you. I'm excited about it. He will bite his finger because of what you are going to become in the name of Jesus Christ. These things that we are talking about tonight, there is a performance of it very soon. And my cry to God is that when that set time that God has ordained, that we cannot shift it, when it comes, you will manifest in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, just for me to conclude. And Moses was kept in the palace. But the Bible said in verse 24, when he came to years. Can you read verse 24 of Hebrews 11? And then we are stopping at that By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, that is, when the set time came, when he was come to years, the Bible said, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Time has come for Moses to begin to do the exploit for which he was born. And the first thing he did was to call a press conference. It was a conference that Pharaoh's daughter never recovered from. It was the greatest disappointment of her life. That press conference was a conference that began the journey unto the deliverance of God's people. When Moses stood up and announced publicly, I am not the son of Pharaoh's daughter. As you see me here, I am not an Egyptian. All the hope of Egypt on me, may it perish today. All the journalists were confused. They quickly went to look for Pharaoh's daughter who had been claiming to be the mother of Moses. They went and said, Madam, did you hear what your son is saying? You know what the woman said? Had I known. I did everything to make him forget his identity. I decorated him with everything so that he will never remember his destiny. I thought I could smuggle him out of the divine purpose of God for his life and make him my puppet. I thought I could cage him so that he will never remember where he was coming from and the purpose for which he was born. But I have failed. I can't stop this boy from becoming what he was born to be. Now I'm looking back. I don't know why I picked him on top of the water. I should have left him to die. All kind of things that madam was talking about. Moses cared not. Said, I must fulfill my destiny. I wasn't born to be a Pharaoh's daughter's son. Neither was I born to be an Egyptian Pharaoh. I have a dream to fulfill. I have been raised by God to fulfill a prophecy. And that day, he refused to be called Pharaoh's daughter's son. The Bible said he preferred to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. As I stop here tonight, why the investment? And why did the rage of the devil over your life? There's a prophecy you are fulfilled to, you are born to fulfill. There's a divine assignment over your life. There's a divine assignment that you are the one. Heaven is earmarked to bring it to pass. This night, as I welcome you to this meeting, we're going to be looking at the set time for your exploits and all the necessary equipment and preparation you need to have for it. Different things that God will be bringing to you. But tonight, I wish you will come to years. That's all I want to do tonight. I wish one of you we come to years. Let me read what happened to Moses when the Bible said he was come to years. Are you there? When he was come to years, Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to do what? Than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. A child that was born to do great exploit for God, the enemy want to cage him with the pleasure of sin, which actually has no future. A boy that was born to bring to pass the prophecy that God spoke to the great, great, great patriarch, and by which his name will remain forever on the tongue of men. And that even when we get to heaven, they say, we shall be singing the song of Moses. But you see what the devil wanted? He wanted to cage him with the pleasure of sin for a season. The young man said, no, I will not stay to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season and make myself a useless nonentity. Do you remember the Bible said he esteemed the reproach of Christ as greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect on the recompense of the reward, and by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Tonight, who will come to years among you? When the Bible said, when he has come to years, what touched me was this. So you know the meaning of to come to years means when he has become reasonable, when he has become matured, when he has become aware of why he was born, he did things. And it dawned on me that when I see a man, a woman like you, whom God has a great purpose for, but you are now sitting with the pleasure of sin for a season, you have not come to years. When I see some of you that heaven is waiting to release onto something great, and I see you sitting in the cage of addiction, in the cage of sin, in the cage of misbehavior, in the cage of immorality, I say, Kai, when will this one come to years? When a man, a woman of your status in the presence of God, born to do exploits, born to bring prophecy to pass, when I see you being diverted here and there, playing around with foolish things, when will you come to years? Because the set time for your exploit is here, the reason why you were born and the reason why you have not died young has come. When will you come to years? When will you say bye-bye to lesser things? When will it come to your heart that living is for a higher purpose than just living carelessly, playing with toys? When will it become clear to you that at your age, you cannot afford not to come to years? So, permit me to welcome you this night. It might look as if this thing is too strong. He did not even greet us. We did not have enough. It's because you don't have too much time to misbehave again. The set time for your exploit, the set time for you to begin to address issues of your destiny has come. The set time for you to weigh issues and say, so, what